And it is again with great pleasure that I introduce today's speaker, Professor Stefan Morent. He studied musicology and computer science in Tübingen and recorder and historical performance practice in Drossingen. After his PhD, which dealt with the influence of instrumental music on vocal music in the Middle Ages, and his habilitation on the contributions to the history of composition in France through medieval music, as I see the title, The Middle Ages in the 19th Century. After that, he has held visiting professorships at Berkeley and elsewhere, and since 2020, he holds a professorship or chair of musicology with focus on digital musicology and music before 1600 at Tübingen University. And he also performs music from the Middle Ages with his ensemble Ordo Virtut. So without further ado, Professor Morent, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much, dear Jan, for the kind introduction, and hello to everyone. It's probably the hottest day of the year, at least here. So if you hear a little noise, it's my fan in the background. If it's disturbing, let me know, but it's much more convenient like this. Well, I will share the screen. Okay. So again, thank you for inviting me to this talk, to all also the team of the Old Myths and New Facts project. I've been following the last very interesting online conferences of the Old Myths New Facts project. And if I should anticipate right at the beginning, one of the positive and very surprising developments that I would not have foreseen many years ago, but not even 2 years ago, it is the possibilities to be able to exchange online so relatively easily and quickly. And perhaps, I think Jan also said it yesterday, perhaps more intense than would have been possible with real meetings with colleagues and scientists from all over the world. If Corona should have also a positive side, it is certainly this one. Of course, I would also love to be in Prague once more. I've been there once during the METRAN conference some years ago. And I recently participated in a examination of a PhD at Prague University. But all of this was also done remotely. So maybe once again in the next time. With these digital tools we all experienced, as is often the case, I think the techniques and tools were actually already there, but it took a kind of push was necessary to bring them together and engage with them. Perhaps this is also true for the developments in the field of digital musicology, which I will try to talk about in today's paper with some examples. I must emphasize right at the outset that Jan has explicitly asked me to present my very personal view of these developments. In this respect, the nature of this talk probably differs from the normal approach, where one tends normally to draw as balanced a picture as possible, taking into account many aspects. I must therefore apologize at the outset if projects, persons, tools, etc. are omitted from my talk. That would certainly be just as important from another point of view. Instead, I would like to briefly outline the situation I found myself in with when I first started working with digital tools in the field of musicology. The ideas and visions I developed at the time, which of these have since been realized, and finally, where possible future developments might lead. So Jan, when he was writing to me for this talk, he told me that you would, in this edition of your series, also be interested in hearing about developments of the recent years, maybe within this field. And I took this opportunity to look also a little bit back and then a much wider look back and then coming to the present time and maybe daring to look a little bit in the future. And maybe this could be of interest for our topic here. So to begin with, when I came into contact with computer-based musicological tools, which was roughly about 20 years ago, I was very much concerned at that time with the music of Hildegard von Bingen. As well as a musicologist inspired by the Hildegard von Bingen Congress, which took take place in 1998 at Bingen, as well as a musician with my ensemble Ordo Virtutum, which Jan already mentioned, which is named after Hildegard's mystery play. I had studied computer science in addition to musicology, since I had always been interested in computers in addition to music, or in first in music and then in addition in computers. But how to combine the two effectively was not clear to me at all at that time. Then I came into contact with David Uren and his humdrum toolkit. And with David's support, I developed a Hildegard representation that would encode the musical transmission in the Hildegard manuscripts. And you see my representation here on the slide, which was modeled on the general model of the humdrum toolkit. You see two so-called spines in humdrum, which are already there, which were already available. This is on the left, the kern spine, which is used for the pitches. And the silbe spine, which is in Latin, which is for the syllables. And I added in the middle, the Hildegard representation, where I tried to encode the various neume forms, which I found in the manuscripts. And on the left, you can see the snippets of these forms and their abbreviation and from the manuscripts, where Hildegard, the main manuscripts, the Dendermonde and the Opatzberg Riesen Codex. I also came into contact at that time with Eleanor Selfridge Field from Stanford University, and she offered me to publication of this representation in the Computing in Musicology yearbook in 2001. This is volume 12, which you see also on the slide. I have to say that I didn't use this Hildegard representation myself for a while now, but looked it up. It can still be found on the humdrum website. It's still there, so you can still work with it. So not only Hildegard had visions as you might know, but I did too. At that time, this was more or less my idea of how a multimedia workspace for Hildegard's music could look like. So this was a vision, so to say, of a graphical user interface around 2003. Of course, this was only a simulation, a mock-up, assembled from and glued together from individual images. And it was not clear from any of these how it should be somehow be realized at that time. So I was thinking of something like this, and you might see that it's clearly a picture from the beginning of the 2000 years. I wanted to have, I was thinking of an encoding of course, also adding the neumes found in the manuscripts. And then I was thinking that I wanted to have the facsimiles, I called it at that time. So more or less digitized manuscripts, we would say today. Options to highlight various readings when comparing to various variant sources, for example, and also having a link somehow to the manuscript, to the position where the variance is occurring. And on the top, on the right, a commentary, a window for the critical commentary. And also, I fancied to have a link to audio and video recordings of the piece. So I would have been happy if that could have worked out like this. But as I said, it was not easy to know how this could be done, because digitized manuscripts that are more or less taken for granted today did not exist, or almost not, nor did we have visualizations of the notation in the browser, of at least of medieval music, or the synchronous integration of audio and video data. Surprisingly, just about all of this, and even beyond of this, is feasible today and has been realized. The fact that 20 years ago, looking back in my own history, so to say, is interesting. This inspired me to look back even further myself to the real pioneers of computer-aided music research. Starting from Emmanuel Leroy Ladurie's famous 1968 prophecy, l'historien de demain sera programmeur ou ne sera pas, so the historian of tomorrow will be a programmer or he won't be. It struck me that it was in the 1960s, and particularly in the year 1967, that many such pioneering works appeared. The 1967 anthology Elektronische Datenverarbeitung der Musikwissenschaft, the German title Electronic Data Processing in Musicology, edited by Harald Heckmann at Regensburg, 1967, opens right at the first prominent place with Thomas Bickley, an author whom one would probably not have expected at first with this topic. One would associate Bickley's pioneering activity with this name, first of all, with the Studio der frühen Musik, or Early Music Quartet, which he founded in 1960. And with his groundbreaking and to this day pioneering recordings on the music of the Middle Ages. On the slide, you see a picture of the Studio der frühen Musik with Sterling, Jones, from left, Sterling Jones at the fiddle. Willard Korb, which was the singer or one of the singers at that time, the tenor. Andrea von Ramm with the organetta, sorry. And Thomas Binkley with the lute. It is about around 1970 taken. Well, Andrea von Ramm, which I also, whom I also knew very well and performed with her also. She died in 1999 and Binkley before. Sterling is still very alive, over 90 now, and he is living in Munich still. So there is still one of these pioneers, and it's very interesting to talk with him about this time. And he is also very interested in computer applications. Now, Binkley, in his paper, in this publication of Harald Heckmann, is called Electronic Processing of Musical Materials. And Binkley is drawing here on his research work at the University of Illinois in the 1950s, where he was working before he came to Europe and started his musical career. And there he outlines basic scenarios for the use of computers in music, which remain more or less among the fields of application of digital music research until today. I've summarized them here on the slide. So, encoding or representation of music, transcription or transposition functions, part extraction, thematic index or indexes, and concordance tables. Particularly trend setting also seems the idea already expressed here by Binkley to be able to distribute rather rare music repertoire by encoding it and keeping it in a storage and sell them only by print on demand to make it for the publishers economically feasible. Binkley's emphasis on the computer's ability to create incipits, indexes, and to discover melodic similarities is probably due in part to the breakthroughs in computing power and storage media or input interfaces via punch cards and later magnetic tapes that had just occurred in the 1960s. And in part to the fact that the use of computers in music research was first significantly advanced by music libraries, music archives, and music documentation centers. So since Binkley was a lutenist by training, it is easily understandable that he also gives an algorithm for transcribing 6-chord English lute tablature as a more detailed example at the end of his paper, which he visualizes with flowcharts in the appendix of the volume. You see it on the slide, his idea of how this could be accomplished. Binkley's concluding resume and postulate, which I've put on the slide here, formulated with an eye to the future. So he said, would it not be useful to consider establishing national or international cooperative centers in which a unified system of computer processing would make statistical information available as an aid to the librarian and scholar? And I think this resume here seems to have been realized in parts today, for example, with regard to encoding formats or metadata, but still awaits further development, as is evident, for example, from the efforts currently underway to create national data infrastructures. So the author following Binclay's paper is also very interesting. It's Raymond Meillon, and he can also be considered a pioneer. He was in 24, he studied flute with Marcel Moise, and in addition to his career as solo flutist with the Basel Radio Symphony Orchestra and others, he studied musicology with Kurt von Fischer and Gregorian chant with Father Roman Banwat at the musicological department of the University of Zurich, where he also taught until 1977. In 1968, he received his doctorate with a thesis on the basse danse and computer applications on this repertoire. As early as 1965, Meillon had developed a relative numeral interval notation or encoding based on the model of Hermanus Contractus interval notation, but with diatonic instead of chromatic interval steps, in order to be able to abstract from transpositions and changes of mode when comparing melodies. So I've put two snippets of his paper on the slide. Utilisation des calculatrices électroniques pour la comparaison en termes du répertoire de basse danse du 15e siècle. And more or less, he uses this notation with numerals. So zero, for example, equals the unison, and one is a ascending second, and one with a dash above is an descending second, and so on. And he also added a similar encoding for the durations, for the rhythm. And below I've glued an excerpt from Hermanus Contractus interval notation out of the Breviarium de Musica from Futoi von Michelsberg. Which, how you might know, it starts also with a starting pitch note, which is given on the left, and then all the subsequent following notes are only interval abbreviation, equal for E with for equal, and so on. And dots underneath symbolize the direction of the melody going down or up. The programming of this encoding of Meillon was executed on an IBM 1620 type 120K machine. You see a picture of such a machine of 1964 on the slide. Wikipedia says storage costs were $90,000. And Meillon reports that computing time for comparing 60 melodies with each having 40 notes was about 100 hours of computing time, just to give an idea. And the encoding was done by manually punched punch cards. In his contribution to Heckmann's anthology, which is named Symbolization of a Melody on Punched Cards, Meillon proposes an extension of his coding system to include chromatic intervals. And his conclusion that an encoding system should be general enough to avoid isolated solutions, but at the same time flexible enough to take into account the respective historical development of musical notation seems to be fulfilled by the, for example, by the Music Encoding Initiative with its neumes and menstrual module. While Meillon's optimistic estimation of soon being able to read and encode modal notation, Notre Dame notation, automatically has not yet been realized, but is currently being prepared by several projects, as I just recently learned in contact with two. There's a PhD going on at Glasgow, and another project wants to tackle modal notation within MEI. And the third author I want to mention in this volume is Murray Gould, who developed the plain and easy code together with Barry Brook as early as 1964, and thus one of the few codes from the early history of music encoding that is still in use today. So the MEI renderer Verovio, developed by Laurent Pugeon, also supports plain and easy code as an input format. And also the tool Incipit Search, which you see on the slide left, right, which is developed by the Digital Academy at the Academy of Sciences and Literature in Mainz, also uses plain and easy code as its basis. Murray's paper, which is called A Key Punchable Notation for the Liber Usualis, deals with the coding for the square notation used in the Liber Usualis for Gregorian chant. As a use case, he mentions, among other things, the search for chant melodies in compositions, as well as the search for motifs and similarities within the chant repertoire. Murray already points out that compared to the systemized notation of the Liber Usualis, chant manuscripts can show a great variety in the spelling of the neum forms. And of course, the melody versions of the Liber Usualis are only approximately suitable for tracking down local chant variants that were used, for example, as cantus firmus or chant quotations in polyphonic compositions. Murray's implementation was done on punch cards or on magnetic tapes. And Murray uses a simple encoding system with tone letters for the pitches and rules for the number of spaces between letters to identify neumes or neume groups per syllable. You see an example here on the slide. Both of these features are reminiscent of the Volpiano encoding, originally designed by David Hailey in Regensburg in 2003, and which is also used, for example, as you know, in the Cantus Index or Cantus databases. Of interest, I find particularly also Gould's design of a graph model that can be used to generate all neum forms used in the Liber Usualis, abstracted from pitches based on relative pitch only. So on the slide you see, this is the graph he points out, and if you can follow different parts and construct every neum form which is used in the Liber Usualis. In the table here, he gives then a combination of letters, and which is the abbreviation, how to use this diagram and the output, which form comes out from this. Since the current MEI neums module can also encode relative pitch movement in addition to pitch for neum notation on staves, a generator model as proposed by Murray could enable automated transcription into character forms of square notation. Such a function is offered for example, by the medieval tool plugin, newly developed for Finale by Robert Piechot. And on the website, it is said that it can automatically recognize over 200 neum forms. Following a similar approach, likewise again in 1967, Morita and Ronald Prender, in a paper in the Journal of Music Theory, present a context-free right linear grammar for Franconian mensural notation that can serve, among other things, for transcriptions into modern notation. It is not clear from the documentation on the website whether a similar procedure is used in Karen Desmond's measuring polyphony project for the digital transcription of 13th and 14th century music. I don't know if she knew about Murray Gould's paper. Murray points to a similar predecessor project with slightly different encoding, John Bryden's Chant Index, which appeared in print in two volumes in 1969, and the importance of bringing such repertoire encodings together whenever possible to avoid duplication and achieve the utopia of a comprehensive encoding of the chant repertoire. As for the Liber Usualis, this has since been realized by the SIMSA project at McGill University in Canada through the use of optical character recognition or music recognition methods in a version searchable online by text and pitch sequences. On the slide, you see the starting opening website for this project. And there was a talk by Chiro Fujinaga in this series about this project. So despite numerous databases developed in the meantime, especially the already mentioned Cantus Index and Cantus database, even today, almost 60 years later, the goal of a comprehensive encoding of all chant manuscripts is still a long way off, despite massively increased computer power. Ultimately, this will probably only be solved by the further development of workflows, which in parallel with the constantly growing number of digitized chant manuscripts made available, can optically recognize and encode them directly from the scans, and as is currently being tested within the SIMSA project and also a project at the University of Würzburg. Only an encoding of the repertoire that it is as dense as possible over time and space, such as the Tübingen project eChant is striving for in an exemplary manner, can really lead to new insights into the generally variant nature of chant. Despite the today antiquarian seeming limitation by input devices as punch cards, paper tape or magnetic tape, and typewriter or computer keyboard, and without any internet from the early time of computer-aided research of early music, this should, I think, not keep away, however, from studying the trend-setting thoughts, or from re-studying the trend-setting thoughts of those pioneers, also today with profit. But now back to my own observations. In 2005, I came into contact with Perry Rowland and the MEI he developed, and we realized that there was no good way to encode monophonic music of the Middle Ages in MEI. This is why we developed the first MEI NUMS module in 2007 to 2009. Here on the right, you see a picture of that time when I was visiting Stanford Humanities Center. You see from left standing Eleonore Selfridge.
Ich konnte das nicht in deiner Musiksammlung finden.
Walter Hewlett, and right in the front, Perry Rowland. And on the left of the table, you see the first NUMS module of MEI, which we developed at the time, and on the right, the current MEI NUMS module. It has since that been, since we developed the first version, developed until today in a constantly growing international community, especially in the MEI NUMS special interest group. And the current version also covers especially the requirements of adiastematic NUMS. During this time, we also considered how to visualize the MEI encoding of NUMS in the browser, and then we developed the so-called MEI NUMS viewer for this purpose, which displays NUMS in real time in the browser using SVG, scalable vector graphics, a relatively new technique at the time. For displaying variant readings of a chant in different manuscripts, we thought of a mouse-over function with notes highlighted in blue. And we only later realized that this was a solution that probably had some style-shaping effects, because there were some other projects who have adopted it at blue color. So we were very surprised to see that. I won't show that in real action, but you can, if you want to, visit the website and try around. In the meantime, there are other editors, such as the overlay editor Neon, developed within the SIMSA project at McGill, more or less for correcting the OMR output, or a very comfortable editor for encodings in the Gregorio format, where you can edit the encoding, and it is realized in the graphical output, or the other way around. We ourselves are currently working also on porting this first MEI news viewer, which I showed just the slide before, to port it now to Verovio, using Verovio, including also the functions of an editor. Here you see it's still in work in progress. It's just came out yesterday, more or less. It's a student of mine who's working on this, Fabian Köninger. And we want to realize this now with up-to-date techniques. Concerning the linking of digital copies and video or audio files, which I mentioned at the beginning of my vision, in 2010, we developed the e-sequence project together with the Stiftsbibliothek St. Gallen, which links recordings of the sequences of Notker Barbulus by my ensemble with the digital images of e-codices, so that the user is always at the point synchronous to the chant in different manuscripts. So you can listen to the sequences and you can choose one of the manuscripts in the virtual shelf above, and you will also always be on the right spot there. A significant milestone in recent years is certainly also the development of databases, as the already several times mentioned CANTUS database or CANTUS index, and our ongoing research project on the liturgical musical fragments of southern German monasteries would certainly not be possible, and we could not hardly work without CANTUS. So here we are exploring the fragments of several monasteries like Maulbronn, Bebenhausen, Salem, Alpirsbach. We also did a recording of these fragments. We're really happy that CANTUS is there, because without it would be very difficult. For example, the identification of such narrow strips of manuscripts, as in this example, is actually only possible with the help of CANTUS, at least in a reasonable amount of time, you have to say. Equally helpful for the presentation and reconstruction of our finding is the Fragmentarium portal, where we put our fragments online. IIIF export, etc., allows the virtual reconstruction of related fragments worldwide. Here we are certainly only at the beginning, with a constantly growing number of fragments and their digital comparability, completely new insights into the tradition of chant will be gained, which would otherwise be impossible. As already mentioned, the melody encoding in CANTUS are available in Volpiano. There's already much work done by these encodings, and we are currently working on a translator that will translate these encodings, in Volpiano encodings found in CANTUS, into MEI NUMS encodings in order to reuse a work that is already done. And I think this is one of the aspects of future developments. We are also currently developing further tools. Just a few look on that. The first is we try to automatically collect manuscripts related to a CANTUS ID and which are available via IIIF, because it's very annoying working with fragments always searching for, there are links in the CANTUS database, but you have always to open manually the link from the library. And we wanted to have a tool where we can put in a country's ID and we get all the available manuscripts via IIIF. And the other is a, what we call a kind of NUMS workspace to add various tools which are available or developed by ourselves, for example, IIIF viewer and an XML editor, MEI editor together. Thinking even further, digital research of the chant tradition using various databases under construction may enable meta research of chant across space and time throughout Europe. Not to find an original or earliest version of a chant melody, as the monks of Solem once intended to do with their graduelle critique, but with the goal of revealing the phenomenon of a melody's variance through the centuries and in different regions. Our already project, mentioned project eChant is intended to serve this purpose and to visualize this variance of a melody melodically. The next slide shows also still a mock-up. This is not a working tool, but it should like this look like this in the end, to see the variance of a melody and also geographically, so that we could basically follow the evolution of a melody over time and space. Basically, to pick up Corona again, we could say that we are looking for mutations in chant. We have all seen the last months and years this mutations of the virus, and I thought we're doing more or less the same. And in fact, algorithms from bioinformatics and DNA sequencing could be very helpful in the future, I think. Now, another and last look into the future. Project that reconstruct historical spaces in which music was performed and heard seem to me to be of particular importance. One can imagine that in the future, we will not only digitally edit and present the musical text itself, but also the music in its associated virtually reconstructed spaces with their historical acoustics. A first interesting step in this direction has been taken by ensemble, for example, by Ensemble Capella Romana in collaboration with the Icons of Sound project at Stanford University. Here, the original sound of the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul was first analyzed, and then the sound of the singers, which you see here in action in a concert at Stanford, the sound of the singers is then picked up via small head microphones during the performance. And from this, the acoustics of the Hagia Sophia are calculated in real time and reproduced for the audience via loudspeakers. In our own research project, Sacred Sound, we are pursuing a similar approach in the so-called Sacred Space sub-project, but going even a bit further. So the slide, you see a few pictures from this project. So we first made recordings with my ensemble in the monastery church of Maulbronn, which you see on the left, and the singers on the right. And then the church was measured and scanned architecturally and acoustically and subsequently recreated virtually. So below you see the virtual model of the church of Maulbronn. And now the next step would be that the singers are to sing in the virtual church space with the virtual sound generated in real time. The goal is first to assess how close real and virtual sound can get. Unfortunately, because of Corona, we have not yet been able to execute this part of the project until now. We are very happy, I think, to do it next year, hopefully next year, to do this next step. You see also a picture of our collaboration partner in this project, which is at the University of Aachen. They have the so-called X cave, which is the largest virtual room in Europe, where all sides of this room are made of glass and you can project pictures from projectors on every side, and then you can enter the room, and with a VR means you can you can feel like in a virtual space or in a real space, so to say. So below you see as an example of which is not the actual church, but it was another project. And we think that it's very important to sing in that the singers also see the optically, the have the impression of being in the church and not being in a virtual concert hall or in a space which is not looking like a church or the original surrounding. So we think that it's very important. In the next step, this procedure could be applied to a church space that no longer exists, but has been virtually constructed, such as, for example, the monastery church of Hirsau, where you see a virtual reconstruction on the below here on the slide. And the musical acoustical data, which could be obtained when singing in the virtual environment, could then also be linked, for example, with the digital edition of the Liber Ordinarius of Hirsau, which you see here. There is an edition by Robert Klugseder of the Liber Ordinarius, and this would be very interesting to linking not only the music, but the space and the location where the music took place. In terms of performance practice, this could lead to scenarios where the performers and the audience are in a virtual space with virtual acoustics. And there was a very interesting presentation with Jean-Michel Jarre. He partially addressed this idea in his 2020-2021 New Year's Eve concert, where he acted as a virtual avatar in being in Notre Dame of Paris. I will only play a little bit from this video. Might be enough to get the idea. Finally, to return from pop music to early music, there is another interesting project, the Revue Martin project in Tours, and it has realized a similar idea with which is called Ockeghem 5.0. Here with Ockeghem's Requiem in the virtually reconstructed church Saint Martin de Tours. I will quit the presentation maybe to because we had some problem with the last slide. And go back again. And so this is a recording was done by Gilles Schwar, led by Dominique Vellard, and avatars are used for Okechem and his singers. Also here a short excerpt at the end. So far. Even though this may not be fully developed today and may seem more like gimmickry, here, as if I once again, sorry. As with my other examples presented, it is a tendency, I think, of where digital research might go, especially in the field of early music. At the moment, we are probably still in a kind of digital 19th century, I think, just as there was the time of the great complete editions. We are still now in the process of first laying the foundations for digital music research through constantly growing databases, editions, digitized manuscripts, and so on. Soon, however, and especially in the future, it will be possible to conduct research on a meta level by linking these data, which has the potential to raise and answer questions that would not have been tangible or solvable in the analog domain. And this is the end of my talk, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Stefan. Again, in a live setting, we would have heard applause by now. Here we must make do with icons, but our imagination will supply, I think, this appropriate sound effect. There is now a space for a few questions for this talk, and then we will proceed with the panel discussion. So if you have questions that are applicable to Stefan's talk, now is the time. Again, you can raise your hand or ask in the chat. So, any courageous, inquisitive minds here?
All are tired.
Yeah, it's Friday afternoon.
Maybe.
Okay, I have a small practical question.
Yeah.
When do you think the Volpiano to MEI conversion will be ready?
I hope the next month or something like this, because this is another student of mine who is doing his BA on this tool, and he should complete it latest until September, I think. But he looks already rather promising, and of course, we wanted then, it should be like the cue should be that the output of the MEI, Volpiano to MEI translator would be the input for the MEI viewer so that we can visualize if there is a cantus ID, all the available Volpiano encodings can be visualized in Varovio so that it's, we have already this, of course, there are already the visualizations by Volpiano in the cantus, but in order to reuse it in a better way, we try to shift it to MEI.
There's a question by David Eben.
I would be interesting about the singers who are exploring this virtual acoustics. What kind of response, what kind of answer acoustically do they have? Do they sing also in these virtual acoustics, or do they just have the normal response of the studio in this case? What sensation do they have?
First, I have to say I can't answer it from my own experience or from the singer's experience, but because we have now to shift it the second time because of Corona to the next year, because you know, you have to use all exactly the same distance which you did, because we want to test the original recording and the virtual recording. So you have to have the same voices, the same singers, and at the same distance in the virtual space. Otherwise it won't be, you can't compare it. And as you know, it was not possible to sing as close in Corona and without masks until now. It was simply not possible. But if we can do it, I can describe that it is exactly, that's the difference. The singers will hear, at least we are set by the acoustic experts to do this, that it's possible, because computers are so fast that the singers will hear their sound in real time as in the original acoustic. So, and that's of course the condition, otherwise they would sing completely different. And that was, for years I was very reluctant to do such experiments, because I always said that we're completely different in another room. But if the chance is really to be that they behave, that they hear like in the real room, and the other is, I think, is even equivalent important, that they also see optically that they are in a church. Because with the example of Capella Romana, for example, you are in a concert hall, yeah? And I think it's very different to even to sing in if you see optically something different. And so we would try to sing, it must be trained, because singers will have headsets and VR equipment. It will not be easy to behave as natural as without that. But
how can they communicate together? Will they have some, possibly, if they have this VR on their head, they will, even though they can have a contact with each other?
Yeah, because everyone in the virtual, if they go into this X cave, which I've shown you in at Aachen, which is a big room, like a normal room, you can walk and behave like you are in a room, and you can see and hear your partner who is also there via the VR device. So, but it will be very, we have to be, probably you must be trained and used a little bit to it, because it's not a very natural situation, that's clear. And maybe in the future, as I said, there will be concerts where also the audience will wear these devices, and we all will be in the virtual space, but sitting in a hall wherever. So, but that's a really future, but it's not impossible. The technical people say it's not impossible.
I suppose this could also be really useful for later repertoire, right? For polychoral works, where the spatial aspect of performance is extremely important for understanding the genres.
There are also similar projects. There is at McGill, there's also a project which was devoted to the music of Haydn. Mm-hmm. Instrumental music, they also reconstructed the various rooms where Haydn made his performances. But I think it was never done with singers, so this could be very interesting to do that.
All right. So the doorbell's ringing. Are there any more questions for Stefan? Or can we proceed to the panel? Okay, so let's move into the panel discussion. Do you guys, especially Stefan, do you want a few minutes to take a break?
For me, it's fine. I think we can continue.
All right.
But it's up to you. If you want to make a break, it's fine, but for me, it's okay.
Well, I think since we are, let's take like 1 minute, if maybe somebody needs to, you know, take a bathroom break or get a coffee or something.
Okay.
And we will be back very shortly.